the whole, before I sort of plunge into my talk, I'm just going to ask you, how many of you here know to cook a good prawn curry? Wow, there, Cora. Okay, great, just two. Anyone else? Luke? Okay. So that's good to know, because I personally don't know how to cook a good prawn curry, so I'm going to depend on some of you. But I definitely know how to catch prawns. And I'm going to be going into a bit of how you catch prawns and a bit about, you know, what I've been doing over the years. But let me take you straight into it. So before I go into telling you how I catch prawns, let me tell you a bit about a shrimp or the prawns that you commonly get. Okay, so now this is a typical, sort of pinnate prawns or the small prawns that you get. They typically live along the seafloor. They are primarily scavengers, or they feed on, you know, tiny crustaceans, marine worms, a whole range of things, but they're primarily scavengers. And they are kind of analogous to the cockroaches of the sea. They're living on the bottom. Many of them have very short lives. They live for about, this particular species here, which is a flower prawn, lives to about 4.5 years, whereas tigers live, you know, approximately the same age. And you have much smaller prawns that have a much shorter lifespan. So they live a very short life, but they produce a large number of eggs, and they live along the seafloor. But as we know, prawns are highly valuable, and they're also tasty, and they make a good prawn curry if you get the right ones. I first learned to catch prawns actually when I was doing my master's work, which was to do with trawl fisheries, and I went onto trawlers very incidentally. And this is a shrimp trawler, and this is just off the coast of Singeri, at a point where the River Princess was still lying around way back in 2002. So that's a three-cylinder shrimp trawler, and it's the typical trawlers that you see. That you would see at one point of time that would fish really near shore ecosystems to trawl for prawns. This is off the coast of Goa. Now to catch a prawn, basically you've got to drag this long conical net. Now I mentioned to you these prawns are really small. So the one you saw there was like about 8 centimeters in length and just a couple of millimeters in diameter. So you drag these long conical nets, which are kind of akin to a long windsock. So the three-cylinder shrimp trawlers, or the small trawlers you saw, used a net that was approximately 32 feet. But you have trawlers that can probably stuff into their nets about four Boeing planes, you know, Boeing 747s. So these are the large factory trawlers that you don't typically see here. But you see a lot of these semi-industrial to industrial trawlers. And this is possibly one of the best and most efficient methods to catch your shrimp. Okay, so if you're looking out for, you know, shrimp to cook, this is the most efficient method, because you're dragging this conical net along the ocean floor. The bottom of this net has something called a tickler chain, okay, and the upper portion has got floats, so it keeps the net mouth wide open. And what the tickler chain does is exactly that. It tickles the sediment, and it disturbs these scavenging shrimp, which are sort of just picking on these little amphipod crustaceans from the seafloor, and chases them at the back of the net, where the mesh size keeps getting smaller and smaller, to the end of this windsock, where it gets so small, and many of these trawlers have like 18 millimeters of mesh size at the end with a double bag. So it really makes it packed, you know. But you can imagine dragging a net along the ocean floor. You're not just catching prawns, but you're catching an entire ecosystem that goes along with it. Okay, so these are your typical tiger shrimp, but let me tell you, most prawn trawl voyages will result in not very many tiger shrimps. So most hauls, you'd probably pick up 1, 2, 3, or 4, you know, and a couple, maybe a kg or less. But most of the shrimps you see are something like this, you know. This is one of the little pandalus shrimps that you get, very commonly called sola in the first monsoon. So, and this is one of the most commonly, in Marathi, it's called jinga. This is your jinga prawn that you pretty much get, you know, all your nearshore ecosystems at the mouth of estuaries. And that's where the trawlers like to trawl. So as I said, it's just a couple of centimeters in length and a few millimeters in thickness, you know. So to catch a shrimp like that, which you're targeting, and you were targeting primarily for the export markets, you would pretty much catch everything in its path. Okay, but as I said, when I first got onto to prawn trawlers, It was not to understand the biology of shrimps or anything else in that. I was primarily interested in studying sea snakes. This was part of my master's research. And these sea snakes are really interesting creatures. You know, even though they're really interesting, you don't have very much information on these species. You have about 20 species in India. So even though they're like, really well adapted to a marine existence, they need to surface at regular intervals to breathe. You know, they can spend pretty much all their life. Now, this one is a sea crate, so it needs to come ashore to lay its eggs and digest its moray eel. But most true sea snakes, which are the viviparous ones that give birth to live youngs, they spend all their life at sea. So if you actually went down to like some of these beaches, you often see them lying on the shore, but it's not necessarily that they're dead. They just can't move. They just flop over because their ventral scales have just like kind of become vestigial in a way over a period of time. And what happens is when sea snakes, as I said, they're marine reptiles, so they need to surface like other marine reptiles to breathe. And when kept submerged for extended periods of time, they basically drown. Great, so we got some good background music going there. And yeah, so this is just a little glimpse from my master's work. It's a really rough cut video that we did at that point of time. But it's just to show you how a typical trawl trip happens. This is UC. It's just off the coast of Singeri, actually. Okay, so this is the time, when I was on the trawlers, I was not really interested in shrimp or anything else. And that was way back in 2002. So things haven't changed too much. And you see this three-cylinder trawler, it's just sort of lowering its net. The net is held taut by keeping the trawler going. Okay, and the net is slowly winched out. Okay, because they got to sort of release it slowly until it touches the ground. So these guys have got to know the depth and everything quite well. This is about 5 meters of water, really close to the shore where trawlers are not typically allowed. Okay, and as you can see, they're sort of winching the net out to the right depth. And you can see the river princess right there. Yeah, those were the days. And you can see the net being hauled in at the moment. So that's the cord end where all the catch concentrates, you know, it's just packed at that one end. So as I said, this trawler at that point of time was primarily targeting these tiny solar shrimp, which in those days was approximately 150 rupees a kilo, okay? But as you can see, there are a couple of sea snakes in the catch, you know, which I quickly separated because I wanted the ones that were alive to be alive, and the ones that were dead, I quickly sort of packed them in, and I took them for further analysis. But you can see separating the bycatch, which is all the non-target catch. So the prawns and the squid and a few other target catch in those big baskets, and the rest is all the bycatch, yeah? Or what is typically called the thrash fish, because it was thrashed overboard. So yeah, I measured these snakes and I tried to mark them in order to get a recapture, but I never got a recapture because as soon as I threw it in the water, it probably got swept up by another trawler. Okay, and that was, yeah, that's how you sex them actually. You determine their sex. So
I was
okay, and but it's not just sea snakes, okay? It's a whole range of other species. This is off the coast of Orissa, just before the turtles come ashore to lay their eggs. And you have the largest mass nesting beach over there, and literally numbering in hundreds of thousands sort of come ashore to lay their eggs, but they congregate offshore just before that. And this is a fairly common scene, but this is not what you typically get off the coast of Goa. But, you know, that's what we keep saying, you know, I mean, we are talking about preserving turtle nesting sites, but very often the problem is not at the nesting beach, it often happens out at sea where we don't know what's going on, really. But typically what the prawn trawl non-target catch or this thrash fish, it looks something like this, you know, I mean, I just pointed it down, I took this shot. Okay, it's just a mix of sardines, some leather jackets, and a few other species. When I was working along the East Coast, so soon after this master's work was over, I wanted to know everything there was to know about sea snakes. I was picking them up and I wanted to go further in it. And I moved on to the Gulf of Manaar, which was along the southeast coast of the country. And what happened there was very interesting. I did find sea snakes, but they were very, very rare. So the numbers I was getting was too low to do anything with. So I said, you know, I mean, this is not going to be a good, you know, topic to take forward for my research. And then I said, you know, I got to look at the bigger picture, you know, what's really going on. Because sea snakes were present there. They were present in, you know, fairly large numbers at one point of time. But like many other species, unlike the shrimp, which, you know, can rebound pretty successfully and easily, these sea snakes have long lives. They live for about 13 years. They reach sexual maturity at about like 3 or 4 years. So if you, you know, take off a population before time, you can pretty much wipe out an entire sort of, you know, an entire sort of cohort for that particular year, or a, you know, or a fixed number of individuals from the population. Because many of these sea snakes come ashore to sort of, or not come ashore, but they congregate in these big bays in Aguada and a few other places, you know, where they give birth to, to live young. So this is the typical sort of stat. For every kilo of your target shrimp, you'd get 5 kilos of this non-target bycatch of the thrash fish. It was called thrash fish, and it was a term used by the FAO, which is the Food and Agricultural Organization, because it was thrashed overboard, you know. And bycatch was anything that was non-target, but not necessarily non-commercial. And when I was doing this work on the trawlers in 2002, everything was being shoveled overboard. All the bycatch, except for the shrimp and the other stuff, was being shoveled overboard. And as you can see here, this trawler was dragging its net off the coast of Kanyakumari, and it picked up this whole rocky reef. So these are all trigger fish. So depending on where the trawlers tow their nets, they pretty much sort of, you can pretty much sample the assemblage for that place. And if you don't really know what's happening, or you don't know what species exists in the ocean, I often tell people you should visit a fish landing site to see this, you know, because you pretty much get an entire ecosystem there. Okay, and as I said, all this bycatch was being shoveled overboard, you know, huge amounts of protein, if you think of it, just in terms of consumption or nutrition. A lot of food was being shoveled overboard. It was a huge ecological, it had a huge ecological impact, but there was also other impacts, you know, social and livelihood impacts, where it hurt artisanal fishers. But things started to change, you know, when I was in the Gulf of Manaar, which is along the southeast coast of India, two parts in the Parkmay and the Gulf of Manaar, I began to see these trawlers landing a lot of this old thrash fish, you know. And this started happening, you know, it started spreading like wildfire. It started going on in Kerala, it started happening in Andhra, and later it even started happening in Goa. So my PhD question, which was primarily to understand how trawl intensity was shaping species communities, or how it was impacting species communities, I wanted to know, you know, why was this happening? You know, why was this change from this discarding to landing bycatch? So I went to the fisheries departments then over there, and they said, Aaron, we are following the code of conduct for responsible fisheries that's stated out by the FAO, which was to land as much and to avoid wastage, because this is a loss of protein. And then what happened was, I said, okay, fair enough, I believe you. And yeah, and just to compare trawling, it's similar to sort of taking a bulldozer to through a tropical evergreen forest to catch squirrels, and you're pretty much pulling up everything in between. So it's kind of the same. And for areas that have been trawled, it actually takes like up to 30 years to get back to the original. You'll never get it back to the original, but it's always a semi-disturbed species sort of assemblage that you find, you know. If at any point, you know, I'm too fast, or, you know, you're not following, just please, you know, shoot your questions. Yeah, so as I said, from the Gulf of Manaar, the tsunami struck, and I was out on a trawl boat when that happened. I didn't feel anything. I came back home, and but things began to change. The first thing that happened was there was this huge influx of aid into areas that, you know, were kind of relatively homogeneous. So lots of the boats, you know, which were these sail-propelled catamarans, overnight they changed into getting themselves new fiber-reinforced plastic boats and going out for, you know, for sardines. And the trawling industry was also a bit shaky at that point of time. Lots of trawlers were damaged because of the aid. Many people received new trawlers at that point of time. So things began to change. I was mainly working along the east coast, somewhere between Chennai and Point Calamia, which is kind of, you know, just on the opposite side of the subcontinent at that point of time. And this is one of the biggest fish landing sites that I was working on. It's in the Nagapattinam district, and it's a village called Akarpetai. And this sort of represents a time when the fish, the trawlers have just brought in their catches. This is around 6 in the morning, and it's the auction time. Okay, so most of the shrimp, the cuttlefish, and your high-value fish, the minute it comes in, they don't wait a minute. It's quickly taken to those ice holds where it's shipped by these big, you know, by the big factories into Kerala and all these other seafood companies. It goes straight to Kerala. But a lot of the other activity starts post that. So this is a little video here, okay, which shows you just what's going on. So as I said, first the shrimp and the high-value stuff makes its way. But then you see the other fish that comes for the distant domestic markets, you know, areas in the in the countries, the inland areas, lots of areas in the hinterland. And this is stuff that would go to the local markets. So lots of the small snappers, the fish that have been damaged because of, you know, because of the trawls or whatever. These are huge rays that pretty much had no value at that point of time, but they were used for their skin. Their skin had value and it was going for the, you know, the luxury, you know, leather industry. So a piece over there would cost about 100 rupees, but I'll tell you about that. But and this is a whole amount of thrash or thrash fish, which was traditionally discarded, as I said, you know, but it's being landed over here. And every panchayat along the Coromandel at that point of time started provisioning their villages with these huge areas to dry this thrash fish. You know, it was sold, the wet weight of the wet price for thrash fish was about 2.5 to 3 rupees a kilo. Really, really low value. But it was a whole potpourri of species. Like I had something like about 512 odd species in my catches. You know, it was a huge diversity. You're like literally pulling from everything from sponges to ascidians to, you know, name it. And you can see these people, they're sorting through trash. So lots of these areas were old agricultural land, which because of the drought and because of the areas becoming saline, they shifted to becoming trash processors. So you can see this bycatch is being dried, it's being sort of sieved through to get off the sand. And based on the constituents, like if it had more crabs, it would be worth less because it's more calcareous. And if it had more fish, it would be worth slightly more, like 7 rupees for dry thrash per kg. But you're talking about like a kilo, which could have as many as like 100 and, you know, something species every time, you know. So that was a huge amount. And all these were being packed into these lovely jute bags. And every day there were about 8 trucks and sometimes as many as 25 trucks that came, picked up these trash bags. And since this was not really part of my PhD, I was not really, you know, I was kind of ignoring it for a bit until it became, you know, so much that I asked them, you know, where is this going? And can any of you guess where it was going? Okay, anyone else? Cattle food, agriculture. Okay, I'll tell you all
export
in a bit. And now if you look, yeah, so if you look at, if you just look at the general, so why was this trash being landed is the first question. You know, I mean, it was low value, it was semi-decomposing, it had all kinds of impurities in it, it was not meant for human consumption for sure, there were many guesses out there, but why was the trash being landed? Sorry? Okay.
For animal feed.
Okay, I'll tell you. So if you just look at the if you just look at the gross incomes or the changes that fishermen sort of saw over the last you know, over the last 30 years, just with the commercial, I'm talking about the shrimp, the cuttlefish, and a couple of you know, commercially important species, you had a typical sort of a scene that you see in many fisheries. You know, it goes up and it sort of it goes through a boom and bust cycle, as it's called. Okay, but this is just the income. I'm not talking about catches. So income, if income goes down, it represents something that's really serious. Because otherwise, price is always correcting itself, you know. But if you look at the cost curve, you know, the cost for, you know, running your trawler, which was primarily fuel, which was subsidized fuel that these guys were receiving, and ice and labor costs. Okay, it went to a point that you should have thought the fishery would have stopped. But then if you look at this this really small curve that has been growing very slowly, but not giving that much of income, it's this thrash curve, you know. But if you really look at the actual profit a fisherman was making, you know, this was the gross income, you know, I mean, not negating his cost from that. If you look at the actual profits, you know, without the thrash, he should have gone bust. Ideally, trawlers should have stopped fishing. And when I was there, there were these whole spells which did not coincide with the close season where trawlers did not fish for like up to 60, 70 days. Okay, despite fuel subsidies, despite some of the, these bases giving free landing space for thrash, they could not go out. But with thrash, on an average, these guys were making just enough to keep their boats going, you know. And this was really serious, because the fishery had actually pushed itself beyond economic extinction. And we don't know what the hell was going on to any other taxa besides those prawns, you know. So lots of other species, from rays to sharks to, you know, things that you won't even imagine. Entire ecosystem was being picked up, and it was being fed to the poultry industry for like pittance, which was further driving the fishery or further fueling it. And I asked them, do you have any other alternatives? And they said, yeah, we could use soy, but it's slightly more expensive. So it was this cost thing. So all these things were going to chickens, to answer your question. I think I gave that up. But if you look at chickens, so all these guys from this particular coast, which is along the east coast of India, were supplying the poultry industry, the Venkateshwara, Saguna, I mean many of these, these big chicken farms in the center, were located in these really this really dry, semi-arid district, where you drive there and you can actually smell the district before you see it. So it's like you just smell, smell it for miles away, and you go in there, and this guy, you know, this meal processor was just ripping his sacks, and you know, I saw a bunch of butterfly fish, so I know that the trawlers probably trawled some, you know, rocky reef area, or I saw sardines, and I know it was, you know, exclusively targeted fishery just for sardines, and literally tons and tons of fish meal was going to these poultry industries. One was here, another in Chittoor, another big poultry center. So you wouldn't imagine, but it's like, you know, these whole factories processing every bit of fish, including shells of crabs, shells of clams, you know, so the eggs are, you know, of a fixed density and things like that. They would feed them, like, you know, lime. They would just sort of churn lime and add it. And, you know, looking at the growth of the Indian trawling industry, which started around the 1960s, you know, the chickens have sort of, the chicken industry has gone through a very similar boom over the same period of time. Okay, and it's continuing to grow. And this change we see as we're moving, you know, I mean, as we're increasing in affluence, we're seeing a change in our diets from, you know, vegetarianism to carnivory. And the thing is, we tend to choose the more kosher meats, you know, being India. So fish and chicken are definitely preferred food items or preferred meats. And I said about, you know, 2 to 6%, and now 2 to 10% of the chicken's diet is fish meal. And it does, you know, and I spoke to various sort of fish meal processors and said, yeah, they give you a lot of essential amino acids and, you know, a few other things which I won't get elsewhere. I'd have to spend a lot more. So it's just a cost thing. So if they got it from some plant, they would have, you know, used that plant. So the thing is, but it was keeping the trawl fishery afloat, you know. So, and if you look at the general global statistic, okay, now when we talk about, eating sustainably and looking at eco-labels in the supermarket and whatever else, if you look at the global statistic, globally chickens, pigs, and farm fish, I didn't add the farm fish because that was a bit boring, they eat twice the amount of seafood an average Japanese person would, okay, six times the amount an average American person would, and 36 times the amount an average Briton would. So that's a huge amount of fish going. And I'm not just talking about trawlers. There are entire fisheries that are dedicated to catching forage fish. They're called reduction fisheries. It's as simple as that. They just simplify everything. You dry it. Mauritania has got like its entire northern coast. It's full of reduction fisheries where they catch sardine, which is very important for lots of the coastal poor in West Africa. And they dry it in these huge areas. And then you have sustainably processed cat food or dog food or whatever else you want with your eco label or eco stamp. You know, and in your prawn feed. Now, this is one of these big, prawn processors. So all the prawn farms have to feed wild-caught fish meal, you know. So is aquaculture really sustainable? That's another question. And if you look at pet food, you said pet food. Yeah, a good proportion is eco-friendly fish that's being fed to pets which don't usually have, you know, marine fish in their diets. You know, so that's a lot of fish that's being used for non-human consumption. So yeah, we do talk about changes in our own sort of, you know, in our food behavior, but there are much bigger issues that if not dealt with, it doesn't matter what you do at home, you know. Yeah, so, I mean, why have we come to this real stage at this point of time? So, I mean, we live on a very sort of a blue planet. A good portion of our, you know, of our Earth is oceans, you know, 70% or more. And, but while we see every single hectare of space of our land in some form of management of, you know, having a fence, a boundary or whatever, the oceans are, to a large extent, even though they're zoned in some way, they are largely, you know, free for all. Now, these are sail-propelled trawlers off the west coast of Sri Lanka that also trawl for shrimp. So they're really small, they look really artisanal, they look like, you know, these fishermen are, you know, are just sort of targeting a subsistence market, but they're trawling, you know, they're trawling and they're catching pretty much whatever they get in their path. And it's a free-for-all situation, and the sea is pretty much open to where you want to go. You can go to the beach whenever you want. If you want to fish, you can go and fish. If you own a trawler and your trawler is registered, you can fish wherever you want. Even if it's not registered, you can fish. You know, so it's a free-for-all. And do you know what that is? A goose. Okay, a moose, sorry. Yeah. Any other guess? It's a wild deer that we get here. It's a sambar head and trotters, and that's generally given to the head who's to the person who's actually shot it, because the head is of value, you know. And this was taken in Mizoram by a friend of mine who works with communities who hunt. But the typical feeling when you see this, okay, lots of y'all did not wince or cringe, but is like one of like, you know, pain, you know, why the hell did they kill this? And you typically hear of things in the papers, you know. If a deer gets shot, it's put on the papers, you know, with headlines. If frogs get killed, it's put all over the papers. If anything gets killed, it's put on the papers, you know. But if you see something like this, you know, I don't know about you, but at least I have a very different notion which I look at it. You know, and, you know, from that particular ethic, I think it sort of flows down to the way we manage our seas. So if you look at typically how marine conservation happens in this country, okay, you have the Ministry of Agriculture, under which the Department of Fisheries is, which is production driven. So if you went to an event where you have a person from the Forest Department, a person from Fisheries on the same table, one of them will tell you we have to maximize production to X million tons, and the other person, on the other hand, would say we have to increase protected area coverage by so many percent. And in between all that, you have a very confused fisherman, you know, especially because any marine protected area, or any protected area for that matter, is in the jurisdiction of the Forest Department. So the fisherman asks, okay, at one point of time, these guys are giving me subsidies, and on the other hand, they're like banning me from doing everything. Everything is a ban, you know. So, with this, I'd like to end, because I want to keep this more as a sort of a discussion. And I'll tell you something I'm doing. And if you want to discuss anything, you know, I mean, from solutions to any questions with regards to the presentation, yeah, please feel free.